It's good to be able to come together this morning as we sing about just reflecting on that song as you're singing, like the lion and the lamb. Like I think oftentimes, you know, like we think of the power of Jesus or we think of the meekness of Jesus, but just remembering like both of those things that he was our that he's the king of the universe, he's the creator, he's the Alpha and the Omega. But then he's also our sacrifice for us and for our sins. He's worshiping him in the fullness of all who he is. And so let's just do that today as we come together as his people. Not a lot of announcements, a couple of things. So one, you may notice that my beautiful wife is with us again this morning. Lots of people are asking how she's doing, so I'm just going to give an update from here. So yeah, she's obviously here, so that's an improvement. Still in quite a bit of pain, and this will probably zap all her energy for the day coming here this morning. So but she is slowly getting better. So thank you guys all for your prayers. Thank you for your support. Thank you for those that have checked in or brought meals, and just all of you as all the love that we've felt from this congregation. So thank you guys for that, and also just being flexible. As I haven't been as available or slower to do things, and thank you for understanding for that as well. So really appreciate you guys and just love our church family. So thank you for that. There will be youth group tonight. All your youth parents, you can plan on bringing your kids just normal time, 4 to 5:30. And I think that is our, and then next week actually for youth group, we're going to have our summer bash, our unified summer bash with other youth groups. It's going to be from 4 to 7, and it's going to be at Good News Fellowship in Ferndale. So this is where we partner together with other youth groups across North Whatcom, Northwest Whatcom County. So it'll be probably about 100 students, bring your squirt guns, and it'll just be a fun summer party with a whole bunch of youth groups. So that's for me, 4 to 7. If you need help with transportation, let us know. We can help get students there as well. I think that's it. So let's pray and let's move back into worship. God, we thank you for all who you are. We thank you for all who Jesus is, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion of Judah, the powerful King who comes in might, God. We worship you and praise you in that, Jesus, and we worship you as the Lamb who was slain, the sacrificial, humble servant who came to give his life so that we could have life. Now, may we just worship you in the fullness of all who you are today as we just talk about the nature of Jesus and who he was during our sermon today. May we just reflect on the fullness of who you are and worship you as your people and learn to reflect you more and more as your spirit is at work in us. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand. Let's continue to sing, declare the goodness of our God this morning.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Come and let your glory, come and let your glory fall. Our Father, who art in heaven, the rocks cry out your fame. Come and let your glory, come and let your glory fall. I will sing a new song. I will sing a new song. I will sing a new song to the Lord. Let your kingdom come, let your will be done. On earth as it is in heaven, every heart proclaim the mercy of your name. On earth as it is in heaven, God give us new every morning. Mercy is daily bread. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus we pray. And lead us not to temptation, but but deliver us with your hand. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus we pray. Father, we pray, and I will sing, sing a new song. I will sing, sing a new song. I will sing, sing a new song to the Lord. Let your kingdom come, let your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Every heart proclaim the mercy of your name, on earth as it is in heaven. Let your kingdom come, let your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Every heart proclaim the mercy of your name, on earth as it is in heaven. For the kingdom is yours, and the power is yours, and the glory forever, amen. The kingdom is yours, and the power is yours, and the glory forever, amen. Yes, the kingdom is yours, and the power is yours, and the glory forever, amen. Oh, the kingdom is yours, and the power is yours, and the glory forever, amen. Let your kingdom come, let your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Every heart proclaim mercy of your name, on earth as it is in heaven.
Rescued me.
You've opened my eyes, and I love you, Lord. And I love you, Lord. You've entered my heart, you've set me apart, and I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. You've given me life, you've opened my eyes, and I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. You've entered my heart, you've set me apart, and I love you, Lord. And I love you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Set me free. Christ, my Savior. Rescued me. In a million years, we will see it then. Was the suffering and pain part of your plan? We will finally see what we now believe. That you were making beauty out of it. Oh, you were making beauty out of everything. Let's sing that verse again. In a million years, we will see it then. Was the suffering and pain part of your plan? We will finally see. But we now believe you were making beauty out of everything. Oh, you were making beauty out of everything. And we will still be singing hallelujah. We will see you face to face. All heaven will adore your name forever. Jesus, Jesus, you will reign. Oh, Jesus, Jesus, you will reign. Million years, it will still be new. Songs of wonder will go on in praise to you. There'll be no more tears in your presence, Lord. In eternity, in awe of you forever. An eternity in awe of you forevermore. And we will still be singing hallelujah. We will see you face to face. All heaven Jesus, you will reign. Oh, Jesus, Jesus, you will reign. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. And we will still be singing hallelujah. We will see you face to face. All heaven will adore your name forever. Jesus, Jesus, you will reign. Oh, and we will still be singing hallelujah. We will see you face to face. All heaven will adore your name forever. Jesus, Jesus, you will reign. Hallelujah and hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
So last week, during this time, we kind of shared some prayer requests, but I wonder if we could share some praises this week, just some ways that you've seen God at work, in your life, in the world around you, some praises that we have of God. Yeah, Debbie? Debbie was saying that they just went to Banff and Jasper, so just the beauty of God and his beauty in creation. What else? How else have you seen God at work? Yeah, Debbie? Thank you. Thank you, Debbie. Thank you. This is open to people not named Debbie, too. Yeah, Rod? Yeah, Joe? Yeah, Nubia? Anybody else? All right, let's just pray together. God, we thank you for all the ways that you are at work, God. God, we thank you for the ways that you are at work and just bringing this fellowship, this body, this family together. God, we thank you that you are good to us, that you are a good Father who loves us, who adopted us as your sons and daughters, God. God, we thank you for that you don't just empower us in this place, but out of this place, as Nubia shared, as Joe shared, that you help us to speak your life, speak your truth, and show your truth in and around the world around us, that you are with us when situations are difficult or hard. And God, we thank you for just all the ways that you bless us, for our health, for our families, for the beauty of your creation, God, just all the different ways that you are at work, God. God, may we not let the difficulties, the struggles, the pains, the hurts in lives drown out these good things that we see. May we continue to praise you as your people, to see your goodness at work. Thank you for your great love for us, God, your faithful love that you have shown to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you'd like to worship by giving, you can do so at the offering box at the back, or you can send your checks to church or do it online. If you're visiting with us, we're not necessarily asking you to give. We think supporting what we do here is the work of the church, but we want to be able to worship God in that way. Let's go ahead and dismiss our kids for Kids Church. So preschool through second grade in the primary room and third through fifth grade in the elementary room.
All right. So we're going to continue today in the book of John. So if this is your first time here, if you're visiting with us, we believe that all of God's word is authoritative, is inspired, is meaningful for us. It reveals who God is. It reveals who we are in him. And so rather than just pick and choose the things we want to talk about, we like to go through books of the Bible and see what God has for us, see what he says about himself, about us, about his plans and purposes in the world. And so we just recently started, a few weeks ago, started through, going through the book of John, which is the Gospel of John tells the story of Jesus' life, death, and resurrection, his time here on earth. And we're still early on in the story. Before it gets into telling stories about the things that Jesus did or taught, it begins with an introduction, and it reveals theological truths to us about Jesus that kind of set the stage for the stories that we're going to read. And so these last two messages and our message today have been a little bit more heavy theologically. And we talked about how the Bible isn't just an instruction book for our lives. It's not just something we read to, you know, well, how do we do life? The Bible, in its first intention, is to reveal who God is. And as we understand who God is, we understand who we are. And as we do that, we understand what that means and the implications for our lives. So there's a lot of instructions in the Bible, but we come to it first and foremost to understand who God is. And so that's what we're going to be really doing today, as we've done the last couple, the last couple times that we've been in the book of John. So just to kind of situate us through again, I want to read through this prologue real quick and remind us of the things that John has already said before we get into the new stuff that he's going to say. So we started off with this, that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. So we talked about, in this passage, we talked about the nature of Jesus God, that when John is talking about the Word here, he's talking about Jesus, that Jesus was always existed with the Father, and we talked about the belief of the Trinity and what that means, and if you wrestle with that understanding of God as one, but eternally present in three persons, you can go back and listen to that first message of the book of John. We talked about that, and that John is showing that Jesus was God, has always existed, has always been a person in the Trinity of God. And then we read this last week. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to bear witness about the light, that all might believe through him. He was not the light, but came to bear witness about the light. The true light, which gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to his own people did not receive him. But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And so last week we talked about this amazing thing, that this eternal God, who has always been part of the one God, this eternal person of Jesus, wanted to be known, wanted to make himself known, wanted to reveal himself to us, that he did that through witnesses, but they also did that through the presence of himself, and how he made us his children through the gift of Jesus, and that all we need to do is to receive that, because God wants to be known. And so that's what we've talked about so far in this prologue, is this eternal God who wants to be known, and that kind of leads us into what John's going to say today in this last piece of the prologue, his last few verses. It begins like this. He says, "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth." So the Word became flesh. The Word became flesh. What's the fancy theological word for the Word becoming flesh? The incarnation. So this is on the kids' notes there. The incarnation, right? The incarnation is when Jesus became human. Incarnation. Jesus became human. Now, if you're a fan of Mexican food like I am, you might recognize a little word in the middle there, incarnation, the carne, right? Like if I go get a burrito, I always get a carne asada burrito. It's the best ones, right? What does carne mean? meat. Carne is meat, right? This is the in meeting of Jesus. There's a famous science fiction story where there's like these two intergalactic beings and they're traveling the universe, scouring it for life. And they come across Earth, and they start talking to one another, and one of them saying to the other one, yeah, there's people there, there's sentient beings there, but they're made out of meat. And the other guy's incredulous, like, wait, they're made out of meat? How do they think? Well, they think with their meat. Well, how do they communicate? Well, they push air through their meat, and they flap their meat, and they communicate that way. And this one being just can't understand how can meat become sentient and everything, right? But that's the idea, is just that Jesus became meat. The God of the universe became meat. We have this fancy theological word, but that's what the word literally means, is he in-meated, like Jesus became meat. And so it wasn't a typo on your sermon notes when you saw meet God, right? Like Jesus became meat. Jesus became human. And so John wants to make that clear, but he also wants to make something else about it clear. And the way that he says this, that the word became flesh, the word became meat, and dwelt among us, he's making clear that while Jesus became human, he did not cease to be God. While Jesus became human, he did not cease to be God. And why do I say that he's saying this? Well, the word here, he says that when it says, this gets translated as the word became flesh and dwelt among us, the word is literally tented or tabernacled with us. What is the tabernacle? Anybody remember what the tabernacle is in the Old Testament? A hut. It's actually a tent. So God's people were traveling through the wilderness, and God gave them instructions to build a tent where he would come down. And what did the tabernacle symbolize amongst the people? The presence of God, that God was with his people Israel, that God was present with them, and that the tabernacle was a reminder of that. And so when it says that the word became flesh and tabernacled amongst us, it's not saying that Jesus ceased to be God, but when Jesus became human, God's presence was with us, right? This is tied to this next thing where he says, we've seen his glory, right? When the tabernacle, when God was present, the tabernacle was filled with the glory of God. And so John is using this language to say, Jesus became human, but he didn't cease to be God. Jesus was both God and human. So how does that work? And the church, for the first several hundred years, like kind of believed that Jesus was both God and human, but really wrestled with, well, how do we reconcile those two things? What does it mean for Jesus to be God and human? So I want to encourage us to think about that a little bit. I'm going to present a couple ideas that people came up with that are kind of like we did when we talked about the Trinity, that are not the right understanding, but kind of understanding what's not true helps us to kind of figure out and understand a little bit more what is true. And once again, I know not everyone loves the theology, but it's important for us to be able to understand who Jesus is and who God is. Who are we worshiping, and what does that mean for him coming to be with us? And so let's think about this. So the first idea that was suggested is this is not right, is that Jesus had a human body, but a divine mind and spirit, right? That like a divine being came and inhabited a human body. In other words, that Jesus' meat, the flesh, was human, but the spirit and the mind was divine. Sorry. So it's a little bit like if you go to Disney World and you see Minnie Mouse, right? The outside is all Minnie Mouse, but inside Minnie Mouse there might be a very different person inside of Minnie Mouse. And so this is the idea that people came up with, that, well, this maybe is how we reconcile Jesus being both God and human. So what is the problem with this, do you think? Any problems you see with this idea that Jesus had a human body but a divine mind and spirit? It doesn't present wholeness. It doesn't present wholeness. Like he didn't really become a whole person. Right. This is a very Greek understanding of nature too, not a very like biblical understanding of nature, where a biblical understanding is that the physical world, the spiritual world, is all kind of intermingled and intertwined. Like this very much divides it up. And it doesn't present a whole thing. And so Jesus couldn't really redeem a whole person because he didn't fully become human, right? Do we have a body? Do we have a spirit? Do we have a mind? Yeah, we have all of those things. And so if Jesus didn't truly become all of those things completely, then he couldn't really redeem all of those things completely. And so the church said, well, no, that's not the right answer. So another idea that came up with was that there's in Jesus, is one, again, not a correct idea. In Jesus, the divine and human, oh, this is not the right one. I guess I'll go with this one. I skipped one. Well, I have this one up on the screen, so I'll just do this one now. In Jesus, the divine and the human mixed to do something new. So the idea is like, so I have coffee here, right? And then what's in here? Cream. And if I pour the cream into the coffee, it kind of creates something altogether new, right? So this was one idea that people came up with, as they said, well, like the divine nature, the larger divine nature, now they compared it to like the ocean and putting like a drop of honey in the ocean because the divine nature is so much grander than the human nature. But when the human nature and the divine nature combine, they create something entirely new, like a divine human nature, right? Anybody see any problems with that one? Is being diluted, yeah, and it's not God or human then, right? So Jesus then kind of ceases to be God and he ceases to be human at the same time, and so it just doesn't really work because it's something altogether new. All right, so the last one I messed up when I did my notes, so I don't have it up on the screen, but the last one is that there are two persons inside of Jesus, the human person and the divine person. Again, this is not a correct understanding, but there's a human person, divine person. If you've seen The Lord of the Rings, you might think of like Gollum and Smeagol, right? So if you ever read, especially the movies, they pull out more than the books, like there's Gollum and Smeagol, and they have different kind of desires. They talk with each other, they argue with each other, but there's two persons that exist in the one creature, Gollum. And so people say, well, that's what it is with Jesus. There's a divine person in him, and there's a human person in him. So what's wrong with that? Yeah, there's not wholeness, it's a split. We never really see Jesus like talking to himself in scripture. He's never like kind of having this, I mean, we see him like praying to God, the Father, but he's never like having this eternal battle within himself like, oh, now my divine nature, now it's my divine nature, now the human person is in control. We see aspects of his divine nature, we see aspects of his human nature, but we don't see the split personality in a sense, right? And so the church said, no, this is not what it is either. So if these are not correct, what we've arrived at as a church and understanding is that Jesus was one person, fully God and fully man. Right? That Jesus was one person, fully God and fully man. Now, once again, it's kind of like the Trinity. It's a difficult concept to grasp. Like, how could Jesus be fully God and at the same time be fully man, right? So, and it is confusing, right? We read things in scripture about like Jesus like learning, like he grew in strength, he grew in wisdom. But then if he's God, he's all-powerful and all-knowledgeable. So how can an all-powerful, all-knowledgeable being grow in strength and understanding? And what we have kind of arrived at is that we don't fully understand. There's a mystery to it. But Jesus had at all times had access to that knowledge. He had access to that power. But only upon the will of God the Father did he choose to access it. It's kind of like the analogy I heard heard is like, you know, we might have some information buried in our brain that we don't always use, but then when we need to access it, we access that. Now, it's still an analogy. It's not perfect. Now, this is, again, like, I've asked myself the question, kind of like it says with the Trinity, like, do we just make this up? Because, like, none of these other answers really, we see how they don't work, so we make up something and we say, well, it can't really be, but we'll just say nonsense that the one person was fully God and fully human. And I wrestle with that a little bit, but there is actually an example in nature of something that is like this. So if you look at the subatomic level, if you look at like electrons and photons of light, oh, photons of light, electrons are not light. But anyway, if you look at the subatomic level, there's something, if you remember way back to high school science class, called wave-particle duality. And what it is that these things, they exist as waves and as particles at the same time. They have two natures at the same time. And if you try to observe them as particles, you'll observe them as particles. If you try to observe them as waves, you'll observe them as waves, that they are both a wave and a particle at the same time. And I just bring that up because I think it's kind of cool that fundamentally, at the fundamental level, we have this kind of dual nature things that the whole creation is made up of. And I think it's actually an analogy of what this dual nature of Jesus is kind of like. Jesus was divine. And as I was really processing this, as I was preparing this message, I was kind of just thinking about this. And like, you know, I say like scientists, if they look at an electron, they try to observe it as a wave, they see it as a wave. When I think of Jesus as God, and I think about the power that he displayed, like when he calms the storms, when he heals the sick, when he knows things about people, I see that divine thing. I observe Jesus as divine. But then when I think about Jesus as human, I see that human side as well. I see the disappointment. I see the hurt. I see the pain. I see the temptation. I see those things as of Jesus as well. And so Jesus was both human and divine. He had a human nature and a divine nature. He was fully God and fully human, not part of each. So what does that mean? Why does that matter? Well, one is both are necessary for our salvation. Both make him worthy of worship. We'll see more about that as we get going, about, well, what does that really mean for us? But it's important for us to understand who Jesus was, that he was fully God and fully man. And John's going to actually say some stuff that help us to understand this a little bit better. So the next thing that John says is he says, John bore witness about him and cried out, this was he of whom I said, he who comes after me ranks before me, because he was before me. Kind of a confusing sentence, but it says that John, you know, we this whole prologue is talking about Jesus, and then last week we talked about it goes to John, and who is John? John the Baptist, the Jesus' cousin. He was a prophet ahead of Jesus that prepared the way for Jesus, and he says about Jesus that the one who comes after me, Jesus, is before me because he was before me, right? And in the Greek, the play on words stands out a little more because it's not this before me isn't the same word twice. But he's saying that Jesus is coming after me, right? Like, I'm proclaiming who Jesus is. He's coming after me in time, but he's actually ahead of me. He's more important than me because he existed long before me, right? So he's saying that Jesus is more important. So what do we understand then about the incarnation through what John proclaims here? So first of all is why did John have to say this? Why did John have to say this about Jesus, do you think? And why does John, the author, the evangelist, tell us that John the Baptist said this? Yeah, Rod? Okay, so it establishes where John's message came. Okay, so that's one thing.
Wasn't John the Baptist kind of hitting some checkboxes of prophecy?
So he was fulfilling some prophecy and preparing the way.
Some thought John might have been the Messiah.
Right? And so John was trying to point people towards Jesus, right? It wasn't just obvious to them, like, it wasn't like, okay, John stand here, Jesus stand here, oh, we can see right away, Jesus is the Messiah, right? There were some that thought John was the Messiah. John was the forerunner. Usually the forerunner culturally would be the one that would be more important. So John was trying to point people toward Jesus. Now, why did he have to do that? Like, Jesus was God, right? We think, well, if God came down, like, we would just be so obvious that we would just worship him, that there wouldn't be any just confusion, there wouldn't be any need. But John needed to point people towards Jesus. And what all that points to is that Jesus humbled himself to become human. Jesus humbled himself to become human, right? He humbled himself to such a degree that it was necessary for John to say, this is God, this is the Messiah, this is the one we've been hoping for, right? Jesus really humbled himself to become human. If you could be born anytime, any place in the world, anytime in human history, where would you pick to be born? I've always thought it'd be cool to like be an explorer somewhere. You know, there's not a lot left to explore in the world. I think I'd like to be an explorer. Where would you pick?
Here.
Blaine?
Here in time.
Okay. This time? Why this time?
Because my family's established. They're walking with the Lord.
Okay, there's a good time. Yeah, I think there's could be a good argument that we're born at a good time. I mean, even though there's still lots of like suffering and starvation stuff in the world in general, the quality of life across the whole world is probably the highest it's been in human history. And we obviously live in a very blessed, provided for place. So that this could be a good one. Yeah, Logan. France?
1860. I wanted to be 11 to see Leon Scott record a Claire Della.
Oh, so you want to see like the first recording?
Yeah.
Nice. Okay. Nice. That's an interesting place. I don't know if I'd want to be born in France at that time, but that would be an interesting thing to see. Yeah. Good. That's a nice one. Logan. Anybody else? What else? Yeah. Dakota. Paris. Oh, the Figley family likes this French connection. Eh? What time period, Dakota?
$19.99.
All right. You got to watch out for the Y2K bug, Dakota. All right. Annika, last one. What did you say?
Sometime
before internet. Okay. So sometimes, so like kind of a simpler, a freer, simpler time. All right. All right, so it's interesting to ask this question, like, you know, right? Like, if we could be born any time, where are we born, why are we born, what kinds of things go into that? We have to remember that Jesus was the only person that ever existed that literally had this choice, right? That Jesus could have been born at any place, at any time in human history. And even if he chose, I mean, I guess maybe it's kind of obvious he had to choose zero because that was the, you know, the AD, BC, no, that's a joke. Even if he chose to go to the Roman Empire, right? It's like, okay, if you have to be born in the Roman Empire, where do you want to be born? I'd say, well, I want to be born in like Rome, maybe like Caesar's Palace, not Caesar's Palace, the casino, but like the Emperor's Palace, like, maybe I don't want to be the emperor, but just like, you know, like some sort of buddy important in the household, right? Jesus chose to be born in the Roman Empire in this little backwards village, know-nothing village, right? Like even in the Roman Empire, like the cities and stuff had plumbing, had more comfort, but not where Jesus was born, right? He was born in this insignificant town, this insignificant kind of place, like kind of thought of as like the remote, one of the remote parts of the Roman Empire. But that's where Jesus came to be. And I was kind of reflecting on this a little bit too. I was kind of thinking, you know what? If you kind of average out human history, this is like Jesus was like kind of the average of human history. What I mean by that is if you think about it, like, you know, it wasn't so primitive as like cavemen, but it wasn't like modern advanced society. It's kind of like somewhere right in the middle if you kind of think of it in that terms. If you think about like income, like his family wasn't starving, but they definitely weren't like the abundance that we have now, right? It's somewhere kind of in the middle. Like Jesus like kind of chose this middle place. It's culturally, there's a lot of cultural difference between Eastern and Western cultures. He's right in the middle. African culture comes up in there too. Like it's kind of this middle place. I think it's fascinating that when we think about Jesus actually choosing where to be, that he's kind of like this average of humanity in a sense. Did you guys get what I'm saying with that? Something I hadn't really thought of before this week, so maybe you can test everything, hold on to the good on that one, but it's just something I was kind of pondering, right? But Jesus humbled himself. He came at that time. He came into a place that probably none of us would have chosen to be born into if we could choose. When he was there, he humbled himself. He experienced humanity. He felt hunger. There's a little bit of debate on this, but I think likely he got sick. He felt pain. He likely, we think, lost his father at a young age. Like he had people that he loved and cared for died. He was tempted. He felt the pressure from other people. He was ridiculed. He was betrayed. He was assaulted. I was interesting, one time I was listening to a podcast from a woman that was a victim of a sexual assault, but she was talking about when she reads the Gospels and read about Jesus being stripped, just that spoke to her and meant to her, just of like Jesus was assaulted in a way that related to her pain, right? Jesus came and truly experienced humanity, right? He didn't just choose a cushy life. He didn't just choose an easy road. He chose to really enter into and experience our humanity. He came and really became human. He humbled himself, right? But it's not just about how he humbled himself. John goes on, he says, "For from his fullness we have all received grace upon grace. For the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ." Jesus is not like Scrooge McDuck. For all my people my age, remember watching DuckTales and Scrooge McDuck swimming through his money, right? He had this big tower full of money. Scrooge McDuck had abundance, but he hoarded it up. He was always afraid that those little, what were they, the Beagle brothers or whatever, they're going to steal it, right? Right? He protected his money. Jesus was not like that. It says, from his fullness, from his abundance, what did he do? He gave. We have all received from his abundance. We have all received from his abundance. When Jesus gave of himself, when Jesus humbled himself and gave himself, we all received. And what does he give? Well, there's a couple things that I think he gives. So the first one is next week we're going to see how Ann feels, but next week I'm supposed to go to Missouri on a trip to visit my mom. It's her 70th birthday. Her and my sister and I are supposed to go on this kayak trip on a river in Missouri. And when I get there, and my mom picks me up at the airport, how is she going to feel?
Excited,
joy. And like, I can talk to my mom on the phone. I can FaceTime with her. Well, I can't FaceTime because I have an Apple, but I can video chat with her, right? Why will she feel different when she picks me up at the airport? Because I'm with her. That presence means something, right? Debbie was talking about earlier, like the presence of being here at church, right? I had an epiphany one time. I was watching our live stream, and there were some problems with it. I wanted to fix those problems, but then I realized, I think it's good to fix those problems, but I don't want to make this too good. People need to realize they're missing out when they're not here, right? There's something about presence. There's something that's involved with presence. And sorry, Rach, I know this is your analogy. I totally stole it, but it's a good one. But that when we give that gift of presence, that it's meaningful. And so when we talk about what did Jesus give, or what did we receive from him, the first thing that we see is that Jesus gave us the gift of his presence. Right? It's one thing for the God of heaven to say, I love you, I care about you, I'm with you. It's another thing for the God of heaven to enter into humanity, to experience, like we talked about, experience our world. Jesus gave us that gift of his presence, that he was present with us. And then because of that, we'll get to this later in John, but because of that, we continue to experience his presence through the gift of the Holy Spirit that he's given us as well. That his presence is given to us, and we experience that because he first gave us his physical presence here on earth. Jesus gives us the gift of his presence. So that's the first thing we see, but it also says that we have received, and it has this phrase, grace upon grace, grace upon grace. I actually don't love this translation. Like a lot of, you'll see some translations, more modern ones, and a lot of scholars and everything. The word upon here isn't usually how you translate the Greek word that's there. A lot of them will go to do something more like grace in place of grace. Grace in place of grace. Well, what does that mean? Like, grace upon grace, like we think, oh, it just showers us down with grace. And it's not wrong, but I just don't think that's what John's trying to say here. So what is he saying by grace in place of grace? Well, he explains right after that. He says, for the law was given through Moses, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ, right? That phrase is explaining what he means by he gave us grace in place of grace, or grace upon grace. So what is grace? What is grace? That her, yeah. And she is a gift, right? She is a gift to us. Grace is a gift. Grace is a gift. We often stress it's a gift that we don't deserve, but I'd say maybe another way to say it is it's a gift we haven't earned. It's something that's just given to us. All right, so it says he's given us grace upon grace. He's given us a gift that we didn't earn in place of a gift that we didn't earn, and he relates it to the law. The law came through Moses, and then grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. So was the law a gift given that Israel didn't deserve? Yeah. Like, was the law a good thing? Yes. Yes, it was. We often, I think we read this through a mindset of a kind of a misreading of Paul, and we think that what John's saying here is, well, they had to do the law, and that was bad, but now we've been given grace through Jesus Christ. But what he's saying here is that the law was a good gift. Yeah. It instructed people how to live. It showed them how to be God's people. It was a good thing that God gave them. Right? And so they were given grace. But we were given grace even more abundantly because we didn't just receive the law. We didn't just receive instruction. In place of that, we were given the gift of God himself, of the presence of God, of Jesus. Now, which is a greater gift? The gift of the law or the gift of God's presence? God's presence, right? And so when he's saying that we have received from the fullness of God, grace and praise of grace, is he's stressing like, God gave the law to show his people how to live, but then he even more abundantly gave. It would have been enough. Like, could God have stopped just, I gave you the law, that's a good enough gift, would that have been good? He could have stopped, right? Like, when if you go through like a Jewish Passover, there's something they do, and it's like, they tell the story of the Exodus, and they keep telling like little bits of it. They said, if God had only done this, it would have been enough. If God had only done this, it would have been enough. If God had only given the law, it would have been enough. But he gives abundantly. He gives grace in place of grace. And so he gave of himself. He gave his son. And this is important for us, especially in connection with the law. Like Paul talks about this in the letter of the Romans. He kind of asks the same question, like, is the law good? And he says, yeah, the law is good. But the problem is we have sin in our lives. And so the law is good, but sin makes it so that we disobey the law. That we disobey the law. And then he goes on to say this, talking about this gift of Jesus. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, weakened by the meat, by sin could not do, by sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin. He condemned sin in the flesh in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Now, this is a dense sentence of Paul. This is a complicated thing, but what is he saying there? Is he saying that God looked at what he'd done with his good gift in the law, and he told us how to live as his people, right? And when we talk about the law, it's not just the Ten Commandments. A lot of times we think it's just the Ten Commandments. It's like the whole law, the whole instruction. But just let's start with the Ten Commandments. What's the very first commandment God gave in the Ten Commandments? Yeah, you shall have no other gods beside me. Now, who here has ever put anything or anybody in the place of God in their life? Right? All of us. Right? We don't even all make it past step one. And so what Paul is saying is that the law, even though it was a good gift, it was weakened by our flesh. Like our flesh, we couldn't keep the law. Like God told us what to do, step one, couldn't do it. But what God did for us is he gave an even greater gift. He sent Jesus in the meat, Jesus in the flesh, Jesus to do what we could not do. Did Jesus ever put anything in the place that God should be in his life? No. Did Jesus ever break any of the Ten Commandments? No. Did Jesus ever break any of the other commands of God? No. He was the one person, the one flesh, the one meat that never broke a command of God, that lived out the commands of God faithfully and fully. He was the only one who ever kept every single one of them. God gave the law as a gift to us meat people, to us human people, but none of us could ever live that way. None of us could live as the people we were supposed to live at, except for one person that came in the flesh that was able to keep them. And so Paul here says that Jesus in the flesh condemned sin. Well, what does that mean? Who here would like to try to earn a donut?
Nate.
All right, I say Leif, Logan, Dakota, come up. And I can take several people who want to try this. There's the way you can earn a donut is take a cup. Leif, you can come up too. Leif, Dakota, come on up. Oh, you didn't raise your hand. Sorry, I must have been Kathy. Kathy, you want to? You want to earn a donut? Come on. Well, this will work a lot better if we have more than two, probably. But this could do. All right, what you have to do, good job, Dakota, and then you can join too, Nate, if you want. All you have to do to earn a donut is you have to put, oh, and Katie, nice. All right, grab a ball. Here, pass these around while I explain it to everybody. Everybody take a ball. What you're going to do is you're going to put your cup on your head, you're going to put a ball on your cup, and you have to go down on your knees and kneel. I don't want to do it because I don't want to compete it. If you can get down on your knees without touching your cup or your ball or spilling it. If you can do that, you can earn a donut. Oh, you're down, Logan. You lost your ball. Oh, Leif got it. Leif got it. All right, Leif. Everybody give Leif a hand. Leif gets a donut. Thank you, guys. Good try, Katie. Good try, Logan. Good try, Dakota. Dakota, you want to know the good news or the bad news? The bad news is you were not able to do it, and you could not earn a donut. Logan, you can go have a seat. Here, Logan, you can have one of them. After church, I'll give you one of them, okay? So, Dakota, you were not able to do it, and you could not earn a donut. The good news is that because Leif was able to do that for us, on our behalf, Leif earned us all donuts, and there's going to be some donuts out by the coffee after the service. And so, Dakota, you can still get a donut. Thank you. Everybody say thank you to Leif. Right? Because of what Leif did, we can all get donuts. Who here was able to kneel with a cup on your head and do that task? Anybody here? Leif. Leif was the only person. You got to put your money where your mouth is. You didn't even try. Right? Leif was the only person that was able to do it, and yet we get to share in the reward. We get to share in the gift of Leif's accomplishment. So, see, obviously you can see the analogy here of where I'm going with this, right? Is that Jesus was the only one who was able to accomplish this fulfillment of the law. And yet, because he was fully human, because every single part of him was meat, just like us, we are able to share in his obedience. We are able to share in his reward. We are able to share in what we could not accomplish. Now, my analogy here is not perfect if you think about it too much. And the biggest thing is that the reason it's not perfect is because this was like an arbitrary thing. Like, well, put a cup on your head, kneel down to the ball, who cares, right? But the commands that Jesus was able to keep do matter. They were instructions of how we are to live as God's people, how God designed people to be and to live. Right? Jesus was able to live it out. And so Jesus was able to give us the gift of his obedience. I think that sometimes we misunderstand grace. Like what we think is that I'm not good enough because of my sin and because of my flesh, but Jesus died and is at work in me, and so then God is going to make me good enough. Right? That as I trust him, he's going to change me and make me good enough, and that someday I'll be good enough. And that's not really what's happening in Scripture. The truth is that we'll never, well, not never, but God's, the point of it is that God is not trying to make us good enough. What we are doing is we are trusting in the work of Jesus. That Jesus was obedient where we could not be. Now, we want God to be at work in us. We want God to make us more like Jesus. It's not like we just like say, well, Jesus did it, so I don't need to worry about it. But it is not about ever, before or after believing in Jesus, following Jesus, becoming Christian, about being made good enough for God. It's that Jesus was good enough for God, and we are in him. We are in his righteousness. We are in his goodness. He has accomplished what we could not. And we are given the gift of his obedience if we trust in him. If we, as we read last week, if we receive it. Right? So we are given the gift of obedience. Right? In the verse, though, it says that not just the grace But it's grace and truth. So what is this truth? This is where I started going and I kind of got off track here, right? What is the grace of truth is the, you know, my cup game, like it was a little bit arbitrary, but Jesus was showing us what it means to be human, right? We look around in the world and we say things like, well, everybody makes mistakes, right? Who here has ever acted selfishly in your life? Who here has ever purposely done something that you knew was going to be hurtful to somebody else? Who here has ever been deceitful about something that you've done? Right? We all raise our hands. We look around, and it's a little discouraging, right? When we look around at humanity, we say, "Is this all there is? Is this, you know, is it true that just everybody's just kind of messed up?" And when we look at, and within why understanding who Jesus is important is that when we look at Jesus, we understand that Jesus shows us what it means to be human, right? That what our understanding of what it means to be human is not to look around and look around at all the other messed up people around us, just like we're messed up ourselves, but that Jesus offers us something more hopeful, that Jesus is human meat as it was intended to be. That we can look to him and have hope, that there's something more. I don't just have to be like all this world I see around me. I just don't have to be like what I've seen in myself for all the years of my life, that there's something more that I can look to. And that as God is at work in me, that I can be made into. Jesus teaches us and gives us that picture of what it means to be human. Right? So Jesus shows us what it means to be human. And then John says one other thing, though, to just so we don't get too far. Don't forget the other piece is that no one has ever seen God. The only God who's at the Father's side, he has made him known. Right? So he wants to remind us that not only has Jesus shown us what it's like to be human, but he also shows us what it's like to be God as well. So he says here that no one has ever seen God, but that the only God is at the Father's side, has made him known, right? So there are a few times in the Old Testament where it talks about like people seeing God. So this might be confusing, like because he says no one has ever seen God, right? It says Moses saw God, spoke to God face to face, but we're also told that God told Moses, "You can't see my face and live." And I don't want to try to get into explaining all those different passages and things like that. There's some things with it. But by and large, there's always some sort of caveat. Like there's the glory of God obscures his face face and everything. And even when we get to this way, he says, no one has seen God except the only God, the only Son God, who is at the Father's side. Literally says, in his bosom. In his bosom, right? Like at his bosom. So at his chest. Like, how many people here have seen me? How many people here have been snuggled against my chest? I think it's my bosom. Hey, you guys have to raise your hands. I know you don't want to. All right, funny story about Tia when she was little. I asked her. She told me she could tell this story. This is one time I was snuggling with her. And I don't remember how, but I could like feel or hear her heartbeat or something like that. I was like, oh, do you want to hear my heartbeat? And she's like, yeah. She was like 2, maybe 3. And I was like, okay, put your head against my chest. And so she goes. All right, that didn't really have much to do except for that I intimately know, like the people that have been snuggling as my bosom are my children, my wife, the people who know me the most intimately, right? Who know everything about me. Those are the people that have been like snuggled against me. And this is what the picture is of Jesus here, that Jesus the Son, God the Son, has been at the bosom of the Father. He hasn't just seen God, but he intimately knows God the Father. And he's come and he's made him known to us. Jesus shows us who God is. Jesus shows us who God is. In London, in Trafalgar Square, there's this column with this statue at the top. Anybody know what the statue is? No, it's a famous British naval officer, Horatio Nelson. But one time there's a guy, he says, all these people come and they look up at the statue and you can't even see the statue because it's on top of this huge post. And so he recreated the statue down low so that people could actually see what it's like. Right? This is kind of like what Jesus has done for us and God is that we see God in part, we know God in part, but Jesus has come, who intimately knows the Father, Jesus has come and made God know, that Jesus shows us who God is. All right, well, what does that mean? How does Jesus show us who God is? Well, remember our section today, it started off by saying that the Word became flesh and dwelt, and we have seen his glory, the glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. Right, that Jesus shows us the glory of God. Now, a lot of times you'll see like paintings or things, and they look kind of like this. And Jesus just walked around like Jesus the nightlight, right? Like the glory of God just shining around him. How many people think that this is accurate? No, right? John would not have needed to say, the one who comes after me is greater than me, if Jesus just walked around with this glow, right? Right? Like if Chernobyl Jesus was walking around, that wouldn't have been necessary. Right? But I don't think that that's what the glory of God meant, that Jesus was just glowing as he went around everywhere. Right? So what does the glory mean? What does the glory of God mean? Well, when we look in the Old Testament and God reveals his glory to Moses, he reveals his character, he reveals his name, he reveals who he is. Like he shows who God is. And so, while John doesn't specify, and I hesitate to say too much what John was meaning, I think that he's saying that Jesus revealed the character of who God is. And I like the way that A.W. Tozer states it. He says this. He says, his glory lay in the fact that he was perfect in a loveless world. He was purity in an impure world. He was meekness in a harsh and quarrelsome world. Everything that the world was, Christ was the exact opposite. And that was what made him glorious. Jesus revealed who God was to a broken world. He revealed God's light not by manifesting a glowing aura about him, but by showing the light of God to a dark and hurting and broken world. And that, I think, is what it means for him to show the glory of God. Jesus shows us who God is. He shows us God's compassion, his love for creation, his faithfulness, his commitment to his creation. Jesus shows us God's justice. Jesus shows us God's power. As we read through the Gospel of John, the reason I think John closes with this is that we are going to see Jesus as a manifestation of who God is, the power, the love, the fullness, the justice, all these things about God. And we're also going to see Jesus as a human, as one who came, who suffered, who was in the world, who had compassion on people around him. That we are going to see both of those aspects of who Jesus is. And so that's what we look forward to, is that we are going to come to a fuller understanding of who God the Son was. The God who came down, who left heaven, was born as a peasant in ancient Judea, who took on meat, flesh, and who had that flesh hurt and broken. Who got filled with the blood of man and had that blood spilled out at the cross. The God who loved us so deeply that he gave everything for us. Manny and Nubia, you guys want to come help in that communion? As we come and we take communion today, let's reflect on this, of who God is, on who Jesus was, the fullness of God, and the fully human Jesus as well. That he was both of those things, that we see both of those things displayed in him, and that God took on flesh and gave himself for us. If it's your first time here, we believe that communion is open to anyone who believes in the death and the resurrection of Jesus. If you don't believe that, we're not trying to make anybody feel left out, but this is something that's meaningful and important to us, and we ask you to let this pass you by. But if you do believe that, we invite you to come and take a piece of bread and take some juice and take it back to your seats and hold them, and we'll take them together in just a couple minutes.
God's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss. The Father turns his face away as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. In anything, no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom.
So if there's any encouragement in Christ, any comfort from love, any participation in the Spirit, any affection and sympathy, complete my joy by being of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not account equality with God a thing to be grasped, but it emptied himself, taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. God, we thank you for the love of Jesus, who humbled himself, took on our flesh, and entered into our world. Who didn't just come to our world to be comfortable, but came to give of himself, even the point of giving his life. We take this bread and we say thank you for that love of Jesus given to us so that we might know you. We thank you for the blood of Jesus spilled. fulfilled to redeem us. That what we were powerless to do, Jesus did in obedience to you. And even obeyed to the point of his death so that we could receive the gift and the blessing of the resurrected life of him. We take this cup and we say thank you for that gift of Jesus and that we can be found in him. So God, we thank you that from your fullness you gave to us grace in place of grace, grace upon grace, that you pour out grace upon us. And we ask you to continue to pour this out, that we might look to the example of Jesus, that we might learn to be more like him, that your spirit might be at work in us to make us more and more human every day. Thank you for the love of our Savior, who revealed to us both what it means to be human and what it is to be God. It's in his name that we pray.